How you doing, Lavinia?
I'm good. How are you?
So you're not rocking your glasses today.
Well, in all honesty, it has more to do with aesthetics than the fact that I have contacts in. Time of day has a lot to do with glare and things like that. But I can still kind of see. Like, I'm not totally blind.
Well, that's good.
You know, okay. So.
And what's going on with the, is that a feather?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So, I was at an event last year. I think it was last year, 2 years ago. Maybe 2 years from about this time. And a young artist created this crown. And I fell in love with it. I bought her CD. And I bought the crown, and I've been rocking the crown ever since. Okay. And it has a feather in the middle. A feather is one of my favorite things, not just because of birds, but because I'm a writer, and, you know, writers like quills and feathers. Yeah, all of that. So gotcha. I love feathers, so I felt it was like, yeah.
Okay.
And I felt like wearing it today.
Cool. I know we were talking earlier, but you were saying that you had some events coming up?
Yeah. So... Wow. I have two workshops, one ongoing starting September the 15th.
One on who?
Ongoing.
Oh, okay.
Starting September the 15th at Hemp Hill Library, which is right off of South Holden and Vandalia.
Here in Greensboro.
Here in Greensboro. And it'll be on Saturdays at around noon to like 1:30. It'll be the third Saturday of the month. And we'll get together. We'll be doing a poetry workshop. I already have four or five ladies that I meet with. It is open and free to the public. So come on through. Luckily for us, those of us in the poetry community here in Greensboro, there are usually two open mics in the evening on the third Saturday, either Rhymes and Revolution or Love for the Locals. And you can go to those two respective places and feel safe and comfortable to share the work that we just worked on. So it's great. I feel excited about that.
What were those locations again?
The locations are Rhymes and Revolution takes place at the Artist Block, and Love for the Locals takes place at the People's Park.
Okay.
So, yeah. So those are those two events. That's for one event. My other event will be happening at Salem College in Winston-Salem, which I'm so excited about. I'll be doing a reading on September the 28th, and I'll be hosting another workshop on the 29th over at Salem. Now, the details you can find, I've shared it on my Facebook pages and also on Salem College's website. So
So we'll drop a link in the description, yeah. And then maybe drop something also in addition in the video.
Yeah. So that's what's going on with me. I'm excited. I'm back to teaching. Woohoo!
Okay. All right. So no other events other than that?
No. Okay. Those are the ones that are coming up. That's it. I think that's a lot, though. I'm just saying.
You know,
that's like once a month for a while. That's a lot of work.
So what are we talking about today?
Well, before we, you know, came on here, we were talking about Buy Black and the nail salon and all of that.
Right, which I was not familiar with the situation in...
It's in New York. I'm not sure whether it was Brooklyn, but I really want to say that it was Brooklyn. There is a video, and it's gone uber viral, of a grandmother, a black woman, and her three granddaughters who go into this nail salon to get their nails done. Now, they get a mani-pedi, and they pay for those services. They go to get the eyebrows done for, I'm not sure whether it was her or one of the girls, and the lady, Asian folks, probably Korean, but I don't want to misnomer, so I'm just going to say Asian, didn't do them correctly. Now, this is a $5 situation. Anybody who's been to get their eyebrows done knows it costs you between $5 and $7, maybe $9 at max if you include that because y'all up top. Nothing more than that. Because the grandmother refused to pay for that particular service, it was not for the rest of it, they came out with a stick, like a broomstick.
The nail salon people.
Yeah, the nail salon employees.
Okay.
And possibly owner, because I can't say who did what.
Right.
Were beating this woman and her grandchildren.
And the grandchildren.
Yes, we're beating the girls.
Okay, how old are the ages of these children, would you say?
I would say that they are 14, 15, 16, 17, somewhere in that range.
Okay, so I'm seeing something about this brawl erupts at New York nail salon after a customer complains about service.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, and so the thing...
So they were in there wilding.
Yeah, they were, right. They were in there wilding. And so somebody recorded it. It went viral. And the results that I remember are that eventually several of the employees were arrested. I don't know what the charges were. And that also there were several rallies, boycotts, whatever, in front of the salon, like after a couple of days. And then there was this huge reactive push. And I have to say that was a huge reactive push to boycott any of the Asian-owned or Asian-run salons in lieu of using Black-owned salons.
Okay, wait a minute. So when you say that, you're talking about citywide?
I'm talking about the video was so viral. Like, it got it had to have over a million hits.
Okay.
That people across the country
are saying.
Saying.
We don't mess with.
Yes.
Really.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Right. So.
That's huge.
It is huge. And the impact.
Me as a guy. Probably needing a mani and a pedi at some point in time.
Uh-huh.
I'm not having this conversation, and obviously I'm not aware or was not made aware of this situation.
Right.
But, and not to sound, what's the word? Anyway, women are having this conversation. You have had this conversation through your social media, and I'm assuming also in person.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that's going on right now here in Greensboro where you all are not going to these nail salons?
I don't know that we are not going. What I will say is that there's probably been an uptick because there were searches and posts specifically in New York where they listed, they created lists and posted them and listed them. And so other people are doing the same. There is a...
So is there a list here in Greensboro that you're aware of?
Yes.
Okay.
And it would be in the Greensboro Cash Mob group, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay.
Because I know that we had done it one time before. Before this had ever happened, we were looking for Black techs. We were looking for Black-owned salons. This was, at least 5-6 months ago. And so that's what we were doing. And so now I haven't seen the... What the world? Why is my battery running low? It was charged all night. That's just wild.
Okay.
Did
you not bring your plug?
No, I didn't bring my plug.
Okay.
So,
be okay? Do you need to use my laptop?
No, I'll probably end up using my phone.
Okay. All right, cool.
So
anyway, moving on.
So in that whole conversation. So I'm going to put this down cuz this is weird. And shut this. Yeah, you can just go off. In that whole conversation about what do we do now? We're being mistreated. We shouldn't be. Nobody should get beat over $5, like a $5 service. Like, that's not it. There's the whole anti-blackness. There's the whole support black, and how that. What's the impact? Like, how do we make that work overall? And so the conversation has dripped into creating your own businesses. There was a meme that was shared that says, you know, it's a black woman sitting in the salon chair, and it says, it only costs X amount of dollars to start to go to nail school and X amount of dollars to start up, but your return will be X, Y, and Z. And what I said was that the meme is misleading. Because, one, it makes it look like it's quick, fast money. Anybody who's ever owned a business, anybody knows that it is not quick, fast money. Even if you have access to, you know, ready, good access to the small business loans and things that are available out there. Even if you can get that. If you, let's just say you can't. You're still looking at 3 to 5 years. For real, for a business, you know, to really be viable and sustainable, you're talking about 3 to 5 years. And that's just, maybe you're making your money back. Now, if you're going to nail school up the street, as far as I know, costs about $8,000, $7,000, $8,000. Okay, that's cheap for schools, but let's just say $10,000. Let's just round the numbers off. $10,000 to go to nail tech school. Well, something like that. Let's just say it costs you $5,000 or $10,000 to go to nail tech school. If you're going to go into a salon, that means you have to buy your own stuff. A lot of times you have to bring your own, you know, everything you need or your equipment, or you're paying a serious whatever to be in there. Like your commission is like maybe only 40%. So you're really not making any money for a while. So the meme is like, yeah, you can make $5,000 a month or $6,000 a month or what? Where? When? Next year?
In other words, you would like for that meme to be dissected a little bit more.
Yes.
You know, everything from your rent to your insurance to your equipment, just to give a more reasonable idea of a time frame as far as, you know, the type of profit that you can make in this business.
Right. And that leads to sustainability. And that lead, and it's also the conversation, of, like I said at the top, of anti-blackness. Because when you think about the nail salons and that they happen being loosely used here, but they happen to be primarily immigrant or children of immigrant or immigrant families that own and run them, then that's anti-blackness because we don't have the same kind of access to the capital, no matter what anybody tells me. I can't see how a system that is set up to hate black people is going to give us access to capital. Not like that. And so we have some things that we have to work through. And within our community, we don't like to support our own. We always trying to get a hustle off, or we trying to get a hookup or whatever.
The deal.
Because we don't have. So if you think about the conversation about, you know, I don't know if you've seen how it says our spending power is like $1.6 trillion or something like that.
Right.
Let's be realistic.
You mean you don't think that it is?
Spending power is relative for me.
Okay.
For me, it's relative. Because if I'm LeBron James, my spending power looks different.
Meaning?
Meaning that he has assets. And he has real estate and, you know, hard assets. And then he has liquid spending power.
Okay.
You know, he has discretionary money, in other words. Most...
Do you think that he's using his money in most cases?
No, I don't think he's using all of his discretionary money. I think he's highly selective. And I think that he has enough invested that will give him discretionary money.
Okay. What I was getting at is, does he have access to this funding?
Yes.
Meaning that because I'm LeBron James.
Yes.
That I can talk to Michael Jordan. I can talk to
Yes,
Beyonce,
absolutely.
I can talk to Oprah and Spike Lee and so forth.
Yes.
Let alone some of these other corporates that, you know, not to say that LeBron James is a marketing genius, you know, by any means. He happens to be an athlete, you know, and one of the best athletes as far as basketball is concerned, you know, at this given time, which now gives him access to individuals that would be willing to partner up with him.
Right. No, you're absolutely right. LeBron James is in a whole nother category, and he is an anomaly, just like Shaq. But Shaq
I mean, personally, I think, you know, if you're an athlete and you're getting, you know, $10 million contracts.
You're an anomaly.
Right. And there's a lot of black people in sports.
You know, right.
But, you know, I think they come in, they come into the business from, you know, lower middle class to poor. You know, nobody's been behind them, you know, giving them an opportunity to look at how to spend that money wisely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they want to keep up with the Joneses.
Right.
So they want to get the big house.
Right.
They want to get the exotics.
Right.
Maybe a couple of platinum grills and the typical, you know, gold chains and so forth.
Right.
You know, and that's probably about as far as their thought process goes. You know,
right.
Now, I don't know if they're getting any type of mentoring from other upper echelon successful black people about how they can take that money and reinvest it and build up our community. And just because I don't necessarily, or we don't necessarily see that it's happening, doesn't necessarily mean that it's not happening.
Right.
But at the same time, with you being an athlete and somebody wanting to put their money behind you,
mm-hmm.
you know, you have to be the type of individual that can at least give the perception that, hey, I want to improve our society as a whole. And these are some of the things that I'm interested in doing and how I would like to go about doing it, even though I would be willing to kind of sit back and have somebody with a little bit more knowledge of these things help guide me or this group in that direction.
Right. But that goes back to the concept of time and why I said the meme was
right.
Was, you know, sort of short-sighted, along with how we are reacting to the nail salon incident.
Okay.
Because it's reactive.
Okay. So what would have been a better way to... So you're saying that they should not be boycotting?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay.
I'm saying boycotting works. Boycotting without strategy is failure.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, if you think about the bus boycotts that most folks try to model themselves after, it was an economic strategy and it was long term. Those boycotts went on for a year. You watch how we work. This is, you know, this is how black folks work. I love y'all. I'm guilty of it too, so I'm not saying I'm out. Ooh, we gonna go buy black for 30 odd days. On day 25, we quit.
Because?
It's getting inconvenient. It's
poor service.
Or it could be poor service, but 9 times out of 10.
Unprofessionalism.
9 times out of 10, it has to do with being inconvenient. And when you get to the point where it's inconvenient, then it becomes, well, you've given me some poor service. I had to drive all the way out here to come and see you.
So you start looking for excuses for
right,
why you're
right.
no longer going to go all the way across town to visit this place or that
right.
place when I can go right up the street.
Right. Right. So sometimes
if I'm going to get poor service. I'd rather get poor service closer to my house than get poor service all the way across town just because I'm trying to support a black business.
Thank you. So that's what it is. And I'm not saying that we don't give poor service. And I don't say that we are not unprofessional, but I'm saying we're harder on our own community and we don't give as much leeway to say, hey, look, this, I drove over here. I understand you're just getting started. Here's some pointers. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm not going to complain. I may not be back next week, but I'll come, you know, I'll make a promise. I'll make a commitment to come back like once a month. We're not even making that kind of commitment to help sustain the businesses, because these black-owned businesses, whether they be nail salons or whatnot, the rush after something bad happens to white people is not going to sustain them next month, because the boycott will be over. The video is not viral. So what you gonna do in a month? Are you still going to support this business all the way through? 9 times out of 10? Ling Su, or whoever, Jennifer, whatever you want to call her, Mary, that shop is still there. They changed out some employees. They good. So you're going to go right back up the street to what's most convenient and what's easiest for you to do. It's not designed for black folks to have businesses that are thriving where we live. It doesn't work that way. Not in...
This is clearly an extremely complex issue.
Right. It's very complex.
Yeah, I would almost want to have a round table discussion or you having an interview with, you know, maybe two or three different business owners, you know, that, you know, can maybe shed a little bit more insight on how they navigate, you know, the lack of support from the Black community.
Right, right. So, and that's I think that's a good way to go. And I think we can definitely move in that direction, because that would be so amazing,
right,
to have different Black business owners really working together to come up with some serious strategy as to how to be sustainable.
Right.
Because that's what matters. I've seen.
Okay, so what's the name of this website on, not website, but this Facebook group, Black Cash Mob?
Yeah, Black Greensboro Black Cash Mob.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you're, the only thing, they have a couple of requirements. You have to look at the list of the listserv as to what the requirements are. Usually it's to share and be respectful and things of that nature. And also to patronize the businesses that they've listed.
Right.
And it's run by Jackie, who owns the African American art store in the mall.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and
is she a younger or an older lady?
She's our age.
Okay.
A little bit older than us, maybe somewhere close in our age. And she,
Greensboro Black's Cash Mob Crew.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So
I think I'm a part of the group.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, maybe we can get in contact with her. See if she'll be interested. Looking for a Black-owned catering company / restaurant.
Right. So usually...
Someone's looking for a gynecologist for young adults, preferably female.
Right.
I mean, wouldn't that be a female anyway? Are there male gynecologists?
Yes, there are.
Is that uncomfortable?
Is it uncomfortable?
Or are you secure enough with your womanhood that you're not necessarily worried?
It depends on... For me personally.
And why would a guy be a gynecologist?
For all the reasons you think.
Really? All the wrong reasons?
Wrong and right. Okay. I have met and I have been seen by both men and women.
Okay. Here's another, I guess this has something to do with the nail salon. Black women go to Asian nail salon. Black women go to Asian nail shops. What do Asian women go to Black women for?
Wow, nothing. You answer that question. My answer is that is nothing, because you don't see Asian women patronizing Black women for anything. They go to their own hair salons. They go, you know what I'm saying, wherever. They go to their own.
Looking for an etiquette school instructor and a on-air personality coach for teen girls. Okay.
Right.
All right. Well, it seems like this was kind of, you know, twofold.
Right.
One, it was, well, actually probably three, because it was discuss the nail salon situation.
Yep.
Then it was to talk about basically Black-owned businesses. And it's one thing to protest or boycott, you know, certain businesses. But if there's not a long-term strategy, then what are we really doing?
Right.
And then three, you know, if we are going to support Black-owned businesses, at least here in Greensboro, there's a Facebook page that's helping to try to promote that.
Yes, absolutely.
And out of that, we're going to probably try to get in contact with some of these Black-owned businesses for a future sit-down conversation about the trials and tribulations of being a Black business owner. And how do you retain and grow your business?
Right. Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Sounds good.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So, you know, so in closing, I mean, I was just thinking about something.
Oh, what do you have in mind?
No, I was really thinking about how I was going to close. Oh. But, you know, in closing, I just wanted to kind of say that from my own personal experience, being a business owner isn't easy. It doesn't matter whether you are Black, white, blue, or green, or purple. But the challenges are different because we are on the spectrum of anti-Blackness. Like, it's for real. Like, it's not a joke.
Where's the lizard?
And so some of the challenges that folks within the Black community, regardless of their different personal experiences, there are threads that we can share. And this is how we're going to grow ourselves and make ourselves better. We shouldn't condemn each other if the business is not quote unquote successful, if it's had its run, if it served its purpose, and that we look to move on to helping each other grow from those experiences. I don't think we do enough of that. I think we just yell at people for not getting their business off the ground in like 6 months or 5 months, and our expectations are way, way off. So I'm still going to support Black businesses as often as I can with my discretionary money when I can and at my capacity. And that's all I can do. That's it. So if you are serious about supporting Black business, make sure that you subscribe to us. Make sure that you check out the hit your notifications so that you'll know when we drop new videos. Make sure that you check out my Facebook page. Follow me on Instagram or Twitter. Make sure that you support the work that we're doing, and have fun with it. Surely you will. I am. What is this? This is Miss Jackson Social Experiment. I am Lavinia Jackson, the one who the show is named after. Yeah, that's me. So what we're looking to do is to have more subscribers. So make sure that you click subscribe and also click the notification button so you can find out when we drop new videos.